following interview was conducted with Roger Yule for the Purdue University Library's Oral History Program. It took place on Friday, April the 20th, 2007, in the Dean's Conference Room. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Library. Welcome. Let me just double check to be sure that I think we should be okay. Great. Tell us where you were born, your parents, and your early life.
I was born in Indianapolis, Indiana, on May 10th, 1931. Went to grammar school there for 2 years, then moved to Greensburg, Pennsylvania.
Uh-huh.
Third, fourth, and fifth grades there. We moved on to Philadelphia for sixth and seventh grades, and then to New York for eighth, ninth, and half of my 10th grade, 11th grade, and then moved back to Philadelphia and finished high school there. My father was a civil engineer. My mother was a substitute school teacher, and my father had gone from working from the Indiana Highway Department, where he worked for probably 10 years, maybe 15, and then we moved to Pennsylvania, where he went to work for Bethlehem Steel. It was right about the beginning of the war. Went to work in the steel mills as an engineer. A friend of his had a company in Philadelphia, and he went to work for him. The two of them then went to New York to work for another civil engineering company, and then back to Pennsylvania. When they moved back to Pennsylvania, my father and this other man and two other engineers formed a engineering design corporation called Yule, Jordan, Stickland, and me. That was probably about 1948, and he retired from there about 1965 or 67. In the meantime, my mother substituted in high school mainly as a math teacher, and I took great advantage of that. She was gone while school was in session, and sometimes I was gone from school while it was in session. And when my father found out, it had stopped. Anyway, then I went to Purdue. I entered Purdue in 1949.
How did you happen to select Purdue? Did your father?
No, my father went. My father and mother both went to South Dakota State.
Which one?
South Dakota State College, which is now
University.
South Dakota State University.
Uh-huh.
But my brother had a childhood girlfriend from when we lived in Indianapolis. And so he decided he would go to Purdue so he could be close to this friend. As it turned out, they remained friends for life, but that's as far as it went. But he had gone to Purdue and gone into service and went back. He was finishing out his last 2 years and 48, 40, 49, 51, somewhere in that period.
Mm-hmm.
So he was at Purdue, so I went to Purdue, and we were roommates for a year and a half. The Korean War started I think it was June of 1950, and in January of 1951, I enlisted in the Marine Corps and spent 4 years in the Marine Corps, and then worked for a year for the Air Force and decided it was time to go back to school. So
you interrupted your schooling and went to school?
Yes.
Oh, I see.
Okay. So I came back to Purdue in January of 1956 and then was in the class of 59. And eventually,
what was your major at?
Mechanical engineering.
Okay.
I was in ag engineering when I first started. But then when I came back from the service, I switched to mechanical engineering.
Tell us a little bit about the campus, and were there any professors that made an impact, and were you any student?
I had one professor. One of the things that really bugged me about the technical classes was that many of them were taught by mostly gentlemen whose language was other than English, whose primary language was other than English, and it made it very difficult sometimes to understand what they were saying. I had a professor, and I can't remember what his name was, but he was from Yugoslavia, Czechoslovakia. He had probably as thick an accent as you could imagine, but the man was so good that in spite of his accent, he was crystal clear as to what, it was a course in statics and dynamics, I think it was, but it was crystal clear what he was saying and what he was trying to express to us. And I think that was my most memorable experience, other than the Grand Prix.
Okay. Did you notice a difference when you came back from when you were here before as far as the campus was concerned?
There wasn't too much growth during that 6 years, I don't believe. But after I left, within 10 years, the campus was just...
And Dr. Hubby was the president when you
yes.
were here?
Yes.
Okay. Then what was your career path? And after you left, what was the next step?
I had had some electronics training in the Marine Corps, and so I went to work in the electronics industry, the aerospace industry, as a mechanical engineer, not as a double E. And I worked for various companies, 2 years with Collins Radio Company, which became part of North American, which became Rockwell. And then a couple of years at a little company called Kratos. I worked in conjunction with the electrical engineers. And when I first started working for Collins Radio Company, we were just beginning to work with transistors, and a single transistor came in a thing that was like a top hat, maybe a quarter inch diameter, quarter inch high. My third job, 6 years later, was with Litton Industries, and they were making the electronics for the F-111 bomb toss computer. And they were depositing electronics on circuit boards, and they were putting thousands of transistors in the space where 6 years before we had one transistor.
Yeah, uh-huh.
It was just remarkable. It was the technical aspect of what was happening was...
Blows your mind.
Yeah. Mm. And then I went to work for a company in Pasadena, which made, of all things, pressure gauges, which was quite a switch, but one of the managers I worked with at one of the other companies became a vice president of this company, and he wanted me to come to work for him as chief engineer, which was, you know, how can you turn down something like that? It was a unique kind of pressure gauge, which I won't go into the details of, but there were only three companies, I think, in the United States that made this kind of pressure gauge. So it was a good opportunity to be in a different kind of business.
Sure.
And I was there for 10 years.
Were you married at that time?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Where'd you meet your wife, when you were at Purdue? Or?
No. In Philadelphia. She was the daughter of a friend of my mother's. Anyway, after 10 years with this company, it was 1979, I got antsy and went to law school.
Whereabouts did you go to law school?
Pardon me?
In California?
Yes.
Oh.
Spent 2.5 years in law school, got my degree, or my certificate to continue practice, and then spent the next 20 years, 20 years, in mostly personal injury law versus a plaintiff's attorney versus a defense attorney. Really enjoyed it. It was a completely different kind of thinking, in many respects, like engineering, because you have to think precisely. But in engineering, there's always a goal out in front of you. You want to go in that direction, and whether you go to the left, around, to the right, to get there, to the right to get there, or up over an obstacle or under an obstacle, the goal is always out there in front of you. It was just the opposite, because there's a guy standing right behind you who wants to go the other way. So he's making arguments to go that way behind you instead of going forward. So it was kind of a shift in thinking. But I really enjoyed it and had fun.
I would think that the courses that you had in engineering, the analytical, the thinking things, would be of assistance.
Yeah, in personal injury, particularly auto accidents and sometimes slip and falls and those kinds of things, there are technical aspects which I think gave me a leg up over the
Someone who might not have that come from that background or that training. Yeah. Now let's talk a little bit about the Grand Prix.
The Grand Prix was, the original idea for the Grand Prix was, came from a group of guys from Delta Upsilon who were having a bull session one night. I think there were perhaps five of them. And they wanted to come up with an idea of an event that would run in conjunction with in competition with the bicycle race or tricycle race that they have at IU. And they thought that a go-kart race would be the ideal thing because of the technical expertise of the students here at Purdue. So they hashed this over until they ran out of beer, I think, and then four of them went to bed and forgot about it. The fifth one was Peter Helfrich, and Peter Helfrich was just fired up. And so he put together a plan to have a go-kart race. He brought it to the administration, to Dean Greer, who was the assistant dean of men at that time. The dean looked at the plan and required two things. First, he went to the administration, to the safety committee, and to the administrators, including Dr. Hubby, to get their input. He sent Peter back to find a university organization who would sponsor it. And since he had been a member of the Auto Club, he brought the idea to the Auto Club. And we embraced it. And
you were a member of that club?
Yes, I was the vice president of the club. And I think I was dozing, as most vice presidents do, when the president turned to me and said, Roger, would you be the coordinator for the Auto Club? And he woke me up and I said, huh? And he took it for a yes, and there I was. Anyway. Peter had done just a superb job of laying this thing out. He had the skeleton of the plan of how it should work. He had written letters to engine manufacturers to see if he could get one of the companies to donate lawnmower engines for the participants. And one of the engine manufacturers took the bait. It was Clinton Engine Company, which is now in a business, and I hope it wasn't because of us.
Was it an Indiana firm?
No, it's Iowa.
Oh, okay.
And they sent us, I think, 23 or 25 engines. They were, I think, a horsepower and a half. Literally, they were lawnmower engines. Unfortunately, Peter was in an auto accident. I think the first week in April of 1958, and as a result of his injury, he withdrew from the university. And as I said earlier, I was a little angry at Peter for dumping this whole thing in my lap, because I just envisioned being the hired gun that would just do whatever he needed to get his gun and get the Auto Club to turn to. As it turned out, I ran the whole thing after Peter left, and there was no time to be angry. We turned to, and the Auto Club just did a magnificent job.
How did you get people to, how did you spread the word, and how did you get, did they build their own cars, or?
Well, Peter had organized, had arranged for a meeting at the DU house at the end of March 1958. To have a call-out meeting for interested parties. And in fact, had sent applications with this letter that he sent to each of the residence halls and each of the fraternities and sororities. I think he sent it to the sororities. We didn't leave the women out by intent. And at this call-out meeting, the organizations were supposed to bring back their applications filled out if they wanted to enter. And I think there were something like 24, 25 entrants who actually paid their fees. I think the fees were like $10 or something like that. And this was the end. It was at the end of March. So by the end of March, all we had was paperwork. No, nobody had built a car. Nobody had even started, I don't believe. And so from the end of March until the 17th of May, the entrants built their cars. We filled in the framework, and we had the race 6 weeks later on the 17th of May. And so the whole operation, Peter started like a month and a half before this meeting took place. And we held the race a month and a half after, so the whole thing was like 90 days from beginning to end. It was just absolutely remarkable.
Did you have a good turnout?
Yeah. I had some pictures of the race. And the
did
race
they have to pay to, or they just came and
went? No. No, there was, I've been asked, well, how did you finance this race?
Right.
And I don't remember that we really spent very much money. The entrants, the race was a claiming race because we wanted to keep the costs down for the entrants. And so we had a claiming race. And what that meant was that at the end of the race, every vehicle was available to anyone, any other participant who wanted to buy it for $100. So we thought that would limit the investment create ingenuity to achieve a running machine for less than $100. I'm not sure we actually did that, but exactly accomplished. But at least the stick was out there. Our cart will be available for sale for $100. What was your question?
You're talking about the plant, but did they build their? No, I talked about the. How did you get people going? You said there wasn't any, they didn't have to pay, they just showed up.
Oh.
But what about building? Was there some help in each one built their own car?
Every organization built their own car. There were some.
Similar like it is today, they get together like the clubs that do that.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Primarily it was residence halls and fraternities, but organization like the Ag Engineers, and I think there was a group from Aeronautical Engineering School. There was at least one or two groups from the Independent Students in the Wards, the Purdue Wards, or do they still call them the Purdue Wards now? The Wards, W-A-R-D-S.
I don't recognize you. What was sort of?
It was the outline, the residence areas outside the university.
Oh, non-university people that live in the community, or?
Yeah, people live in apartments around town.
And that's all. They're still registered as a student, though, are they?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, but they live off campus.
Yeah, they live off campus.
Okay,
right.
Okay.
But there were a couple of cars entered by them, by individual groups that had no university affiliation other than just being students.
Let me ask you a question. What was, you talked about the Independence, was that a club, or what was the Independence?
When I went to school, there were Greeks and Independents. Or one or the other.
I see. Okay.
So
that clarifies it for me, because I'm an independent. If I'm thinking of the researchers and want to know what independent from what,
okay.
You know, we have putting it in today's context, but we need to put it in the context at that time.
Okay.
So
these were students who did not have Greek affiliations. That was,
okay.
That's there were many of us, and for many reasons. Anyway, but that did not prevent us. I mean, but this organization was open to everybody.
Now you mentioned her a little bit earlier before we got started about the Queen. you decide, they decide you ought to have a...
It was about a week before the race. Somebody's made the suggestion that we have a queen and said, well, we ought to have a competition. And I said, we don't have time for a competition. And so I talked to a friend of mine. Let's see, 1958. I was married in 1958, so I was not socializing on campus, so I didn't know many women. And there were many women in the engineering school at that time. So this friend of mine who was lived in the residence hall with me said, I know a girl perfect for this. She's a nice gal, she's good looking, she's attractive. So we had coffee or something together, and he was absolutely right. She's a lovely lady, and she agreed. She's just nuts enough to agree to do something like this. And
what did the winner get?
It was a trophy about 8 inches high, maybe 10 inches high. And,
no milk, right?
No. He did get a kiss from the queen, though, which I understand was a contention about queens and things.
I have a question. You were talking that they decided in the earlier to base it a little bit or model a little bit on the Indiana. Wouldn't you thought that, didn't they think about something to the Indy 500? Because that was going on at that time. Those were cars.
Well, it was kind of...
Or maybe that ran through their thinking process, perhaps, or...
Well, Indiana is a racing state. Two things in Indiana, basketball and racing.
Right.
And so... The go-kart idea was, you know, just fell out from that.
Sure.
Let me add, though, that after the first race, we had this 8 or 10 inch high trophy that we gave. I'm not even sure it was engraved, but maybe we put something on it. Anyway, after the first race, Corrigan Hall, who was the Alumni Association director, called me, and he foresaw what this could be. The auto club was just going year to year. I mean, good, let's do it again next year. Cordy Hall saw the potential, and he called me and asked if the Alumni Association could help. So the next year,
this is 1960.
No, 1959.
Oh, 58 was the first year. Sorry.
59. Cordy bought this trophy that was similar to the Indianapolis trophy.
The Bud Warner trophy.
Not quite as tall. It might have been 2 feet, 2.5 feet tall, something like that, with room for lots of names on it, lots of inscriptions, and also. Printed up a very professional-looking program. And so that was the Alumni Association's contribution to the second race, and they've been a party to it ever since. And it's all due to Cordy Hall. He's a great guy, by the way.
Did you get sponsorship? I mean, how did that come about? For the race, anybody, except for the motors that you got, weren't any sponsors?
No. We didn't really spend too much money.
Was the race run in the afternoon?
Race
what about trials? Didn't have time trials?
No.
Just the day of the race?
There were only 21 cars that actually passed all of the tests and were on the starting line. So we could run all 21 at the same time.
Okay.
So we didn't have to have time trials.
Talk about the race or then afterwards?
As far as expenses, the only outside services we had were the West Lafayette Fire Department brought an engine company. We coordinated with them as to where they thought they should be, and so we made provision to have them available. And also, I think we had an ambulance. I'm not sure it was a paramedic ambulance, but we had one on the site. Again, out of view of the participants and the audience, the spectators. But we did have safety precautions in place. Everybody else was a student. The auto club, there were auto club members, were the supervisors or the track stewards, the pit stewards, the safety inspections, all of that stuff was handled by students from the auto club.
Okay.
The crowd control was done. We invited the arenas, the tomahawks, the cold peppers, the gimlets, the ROTC, and a couple of organizations to come and be, and just stand around the perimeter, which we had barricaded off, either with tape or with regular barricades. And they just stood behind the barricades. And there were enough of them that on our side of the barricade, that the people on the other side understood that they shouldn't go across the barricade. And we had absolutely no problem with the spectators.
Don't forget about the flags. That was the mention about the flags. That was...
We used the SCCA. I had run some SCCA events prior to that. And we used the SCCA flagging system. I think it was a yellow flag for oil, for caution. Let me say, the system was that on each corner, on each turn, there would be somebody holding a flag. It was either a green flag to let the drivers know as they entered that corner that everything was okay around the corner, a yellow flag to let them know that there was something to slow down and take it easy because something was going on around the corner. A green flag just to indicate, I don't finish that, a red flag to stop the race. If it was required, they would just show a red flag, and that meant stop. There was another flag too, I don't remember what it was. Anyway, the flags were not purchased. We bought pieces of dowel and put cloth that we bought from one of the shops downtown. Made our own flags. And each of the groups that was inside the barrier had an armband. The crowd control people had one color armband. The technical people, the safety people in the pits had another color of armband. The participants had that's the only color I really remember was the participants had a white armband. And the reason I remember it is because there were 120 of them. We cut strips of material, white material, and then had a staple, or a stencil, that we stenciled PGP on each one of these armbands, and that was our deep, dark secret. Nobody knew, except for a couple of us, how the people inside the barrier were going to be identified, because we were paranoid about safety, and we didn't want anybody to copy our armbands, or whatever device we were going to use, whether it was nameplates or whatever it was, to be able to counterfeit them and get inside the barrier. And they were these things, like we said, only a couple of people knew about it, and they were passed out the morning of the race. And so, didn't have any problem that I'm aware of people getting inside who shouldn't have been there.
How did it morph us into the Purdue, or the Grand Prix Foundation, which...
That was beyond when I was here.
Because when you were, even after you left, it was still the auto club that...
My understanding is the auto club existed until about sometime in the mid-60s, 65, somewhere in there.
Okay.
But there was... I saw something the other day that reminded me that although the initial goals of the race were to encourage inventiveness and the ingenuity of students. Not just the engineering students, but any student. Didn't make any difference. It could be sociology or pharmacy or ag or whatever. But if they had a mechanical bent, they could design a car and enter. So to engender ingenuity, not spend a lot of money, so we had the $100 claim. Have fun and be safe. Those were the four goals. And depending on who you were, it depended on what sequence those goals fell. The administration safety was first. With the participants, I'm not sure whether having fun or winning was the goal.
Did Dr. Hubby come to the race?
No. I didn't see a single administrator, anybody from the administration.
Not even the dean of Dr. Greer?
No. I think the dean was our angel in the administration.
The what?
The dean, Dean Greer was our angel. But I
you
think
said he was the dean of men, is that it?
Yeah, the assistant dean of men. Mm-hmm. But I think everyone was really frightened about the possibility of somebody being injured. And so nobody from the administration showed up. As I said, the whole thing was run by the students. But I take that back. We had a faculty advisor. Professor Harold Montgomery.
Yes, they do today. All the clubs have advisors.
Yes. Great guy. That's one of my fondest memories of HA. His name was Harold A. Montgomery, and his close associates called him HA. And after being in this boiling pot for several months with him, we were on a first name basis. But he was a great guy. One of the sidelights of this whole thing, we took a very fundamental approach to everything that we did. As for instance, we required that the frames be of these vehicles be strong enough to survive the race and not come apart. Well, how the heck are you going to do that on a practical basis without going to the test laboratory and then put blocks on, you know, and see what. So Harold Montgomery, who was about 5'8" and weighed 250 pounds, would stand on the cart. He would straddle the cart frame and jump up and down on the cart frame. You know, didn't bend or break. It worked. Now, you can say, well, gee whiz, you know, that's a heck of a test. How do you make that fair? Well, it was fair because every cart went through the same test. The same guy, the same bounces, that was it.
That was the game plan.
Yep. As far as ingenuity is concerned, at the first race, all the carts except one were built out of tubing or sheet metal, some kind of metal. One car from Cary West was built out of fiberglass. That's 1958.
Wow.
And they did, I think they ended up second or third in the race. But they used fiberglass tubing, fiberglass plates. They even had I don't remember whether the roll bar was made out of fiberglass, because I think we required a chrome moly roll bar. But I don't remember.
Yeah. But it's amazing that there were no injuries and everything went off well.
Yes. Let's see, of the 21 that started, I don't think there were any records kept, but my recollection, it was the high number, the high teens finished the race.
That's very good. And you had a good day. Was it in the afternoon?
Yes. Beautiful day.
That
just
worked.
Beautiful.
That would have not been good if the weather wasn't good. After all the planning.
Yeah, to give you the importance of this event, as far as the administration was concerned, we had planned to start like at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. There was some kind of a practice going on, and this practice field that was next to where we had the race, which was on the intramural drive, there was a practice of some sort, something going on in that field. Administration said, told us, no, you can't interfere with the practice. So we have to close off the street, close off the parking lot. So no, you can't do that until 5 o'clock in the afternoon, up to 3:30 in the afternoon. So we ran the race from 3:30 in the afternoon until 5.
Oh, not too bad.
However, after the race was over, not only did Cordy Hull call me, but Dr. Hull called. And so it was
called you?
Dr. Hull, Dean Greer, C.W. DeMint, who was the Purdue safety engineer, I believe, the head of the safety department.
Was that Clayton DeMint?
Yeah.
DeMint?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. They named the fire station. I think I met him one time.
Okay.
Nice person.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
Yeah. Tough.
Yeah,
oh,
this was in some committee or something. It had nothing to do with it. But.
He was tough. He knew his job, and he demanded that certain things be done.
That's what he's there for.
And anyway, the five of us, H.A. and I, were called into President Hubby's office, and he complimented us on the race, on the success of the race. And President Hubby was the starting flagman at the beginning of next year. And the race was no longer held in front of the H halls. It was held in front of the administration building.
Where they used to have the...
On the circle, right?
Right.
Around the circle.
Very good.
And the streets in that area.
Yeah. Did they sell food? Did you have, like, the concessions at all or not? Do you remember that?
I don't think so.
Okay. Do you remember at one time when they used to have Grand Prix, there was a carnival that used to be held? Of course, the Grand Prix lot where they run it now, that was when Dr. Hansen gave that, let them use it. But at one time, there used to be a carnival that would be further over, but they've been gone for some years.
Yeah,
and families used to say that when their children were younger, they would go, the carnival would start maybe Thursday and do at least through Saturday night or something like that.
No, we didn't. Our goal was to hold the race. As the auto club, our goal was to hold the race.
Sure.
And that was it.
Yeah.
And I think probably as long as the auto club ran it, that's probably all that happened.
What was the village like when you were here? Is it
being down along State Street. I drove up there today and I didn't recognize. I recognized some of the names, like University Bookstore and what's the other one? Follett,
yes. Well, Harry's you'd recognize.
Well, I recognized the sign, but I don't think the store is the same.
Is it still the
same structure?
Yes. Harry's Chocolate Shop. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I remembered it as being kind of a building, a single-story building.
No, to the best of my knowledge, that's where he's always been. And then
it's always been there.
Yeah, Voss, the bookstore. They had a fire about a year and a half ago, the roof, they had some apartments up above, and nobody died, but it was more on the Vons side. Vons is right next to it, you know.
But probably a lot of silt beer in the front of the store now, in the front of the shop.
Well, you can go in there, and they've still got all the handwriting on the wall and all this jazz. I haven't been in there for a while, but it of course, when the lums and everything come back, the line is, you know, all the way. Because
yeah.
That's the thing that it's been here. But the levee has changed a lot since you've been here. And of course, now we have Wabash Landing. Been the last few years.
If I recall, McDonald's was on the other side of the street, down close to the bridge.
Right.
There was a Sears store down there with a huge parking lot.
Right. And do you remember, was Bruno's here when you were here?
The name sounds familiar.
Well, Bruno's came in 55. And Bruno's used to be at the corner of State and South River Road, where now they've expanded that up to 231. And Bruno's had property across the way, so they moved over there, across the street. There used to be a gas station. There was a Shell station there. They're over near where Sears probably would have been, but they're not there anymore. But that's where Bruno's has been here since 55. So, and it's a nice place. Yeah. Any favorite memory of Purdue, Lazy, or outstanding event in your life, or both?
Other than the Grand Prix.
Then that takes care of it. What are you, then you, been in California all your life? You still reside? Are you still working?
I moved there in 1959, and I've been there ever since. Uh-huh. No, I retired in 1999.
Okay.
And, well, I retired from active practice, but I've been doing arbitrations for the San Bernardino Court, San Bernardino County Court, and the Riverside County Court. For court-ordered arbitrations, and it keeps my hand in it, maybe a dozen of them a year.
Sure. Okay. Do you do some traveling and other things in your town?
As a matter of fact, let's see.
Did you drive from here to come?
No, we flew into Indianapolis and then drove up. We were in Northern California 2 weeks ago, spent a week in the wine country checking out the wine. Had a few days in San Francisco, and then a couple of days with my stepdaughter. And then this week we're here at Purdue, and we're going on to Fort Wayne to visit my my wife's family. And then this is not the same wife that was here with me in that law school. Took care of it. Law school was such a traumatic event in terms of study and learning new concepts. I wasn't the same person when I finished law school.
Well, has it been a change since you've been in school and you've been working and then to go take, you know, a shift, 360-degree shift? Yeah.
Well, anyway, after I finished law school, very shortly thereafter I was divorced. And a year later I met this young lady. Well, she's not. When I started dating again, I had three requirements. I wasn't going to be one of those old fools that had a chickie on his arm. So my requirement at the time, I was 51. Number one, she could have had to be at least 40 years old. Number two, not married. And number three, like classical music. And I found the perfect one. And we've been married for... Well, we celebrate our 20th anniversary. We'll be somewhere on the Greek islands on the 9th of May. So, in answer to your question, there
Very
you are.
Nice.
We're here this week, and then on May the 4th, we leave for Athens for a cruise to the Greek islands. And hopefully our captain will know where the rocks are at Santorini.
Yeah. Well, I think anything special in closing, or you think anything you want to make a comment on?
Well, as a result of this 50th anniversary, two of the guys who were in the original five that thought up this idea, Larry Miller and Tom Pearson, have put together a history of the Grand Prix and have actually made a CD, which apparently is going to be on sale through the Grand Prix Foundation, and any proceeds go into the Foundation Scholarship Fund. But I met these two guys by email, and we've conversed now for the last, and both of them were involved in either the first or the second race as participants. So we've been conversing probably for the last 5 months on email. I've never met them in my life. And we're going to meet tonight at the reception that's being held by the Grand Prix Foundation.
Oh, good.
So I'm really looking forward to that.
That's very nice.
These guys sound like kindred spirits.
Reminiscing, right? Okay.